Today we are going to see about the anatomy of the great saphenous vein. The great saphenous vein is one of the superficial veins of the lower limb. These veins are lying in the superficial fascia of the lower limb. This is also called as a long saphenous vein. And as the name says, this is the longest vein of the body. This extends from the dorsum of the foot up to the upper part of the thigh. So this is the longest vein of the body. And these are having large number of valves, as any vein does, which is ensuring a unidirectional flow of blood from the lower part of the body up to the heart. And this is representing the preaxial vein of the lower limb. Now, let us see what is the cause of this vein. So how does this vein originate? This is originating from the dorsum of the foot. So in the dorsum of the foot, we have the dorsal venous arch. The medial part of this dorsal venous arch is joining with the medial marginal vein of the foot. And this is what forms the great saphenous vein. Now, what about the cause? This is ascending only along the medial borders of the leg. Now, from the medial part of the foot, this is ascending upwards, and this vein initially lies anterior to the medial malleolus. This is about 2.5 centimeters anterior to the medial malleolus. And then later on, this is ascending upwards along the medial margin of the leg, and this will go to the posteromedial aspect of the knee joint, about one hand breadth posterior. So from the medial margin of the leg, this will be crossing obliquely, and the vein will be present posteromedial to the knee joint, about one hand breadth. And after that, this will be again crossing, and this will be ascending along the medial border of the thigh as it terminates into the deep vein. Now, what about the termination? There is an opening in the deep fascia. The deep fascia of the leg is also called as a fascia lata. There is one opening in the fascia lata that is in the upper part of the thigh. That is what we call as a saphenous opening. Now, what is a saphenous opening? This is an opening in the deep fascia where the saphenous vein enters and fuses with the femoral vein. That is a deep vein of the leg. Femoral vein is a deep vein of the leg, and the saphenous vein passes through the saphenous opening and joins into the femoral vein. Now, the saphenous opening, above the saphenous opening, we can see there is a layer of areolar tissue or fascia. That is what we call as cribriform fascia. Now, why do we call this as cribriform fascia? There are large number of structures piercing this fascia, so it has a perforated appearance. So hence we call this as the cribriform fascia. So large number of lymphatic vessels and also large number of veins are piercing this fascia. That's why this has a perforated appearance. So the saphenous vein pierces the cribriform fascia, and it later on joins into the femoral vein, which is lying deep. Now, there is one valve which is present in this junction. We call this a saphenofemoral junction. And there is one valve which is present in this junction, which ensures that blood flows only from saphenous vein to the femoral vein. So if there is any problem associated with this valve, there can be accumulation of blood in the superficial vein, which we'll see later. So this is the cause of the saphenous vein and how it is originating from the dorsal venous arch up to and ending up in the femoral vein, passing through the saphenous opening. What about the surface marking of the great saphenous vein? So we can see at four different regions. How about in the angle? We saw that as it originates from the dorsal venous arch, this vein is lying anterior to the medial malleolus. So in the angle portion, this is lying 2.5 centimeters anterior to the medial malleolus. How about in the leg? It is passing along the medial border of the leg. So we can say this is medial border of the leg and also in the medial border of the tibia. How about in the knee joint? The vein is lying posterior to the knee joint, so posteromedial end of the knee joint, which is one hand breadth. One hand breadth posteromedial to the knee joint lies the saphenous vein. How about in the thigh? In the thigh, this is ascending along the medial border of the thigh and finally terminates by opening into the saphenous opening. Now, where is the saphenous opening situated? The saphenous opening is situated 3.5 to 4 centimeters infralateral to the pubic tubercle. So it is in the upper part of the thigh. So saphenous opening 3.5 to 4 centimeters infralateral to the pubic tubercle. So that is how the vein terminates. Now let's look at the tributaries. At the site of origin, we saw this is formed by the fusion of medial marginal vein of foot with the medial part of the dorsal vein as such. So we can say that as one tributary. In the leg, there are mainly two tributaries. We have an anterior leg vein and there is one posterior arch vein. Now there are a few smaller veins which we are calling as communicating veins or perforating veins. Now what are these? We will see later. So these are the main tributaries in the leg. about in the thigh? We have mainly two veins. We have the anterolateral vein and the posteromedial vein. Now, after in the thigh, now finally it enters into the saphenous opening. Now, as it enters into the saphenous opening, three other veins are joining with the saphenous vein, and these are superficial epigastric vein, superficial circumflex iliac vein, and superficial external pudendal vein. These three veins joins with the saphenous vein at this region. Now, after it crosses the saphenous opening and before it fuses into the femoral vein, we have one more vein, that is the deep external pudendal vein, which is joining along with the saphenous vein into the femoral vein. So we can call these veins as the tributaries of saphenous vein. Now we saw one class of veins which are called as perforating veins or communicating veins. So these veins are small veins which are arising from the superficial veins, and they are connecting directly the superficial veins into the deep veins. And such veins are called as communicating veins. Now, why do we call them as perforators? Is because these veins are perforating the deep fascia. That's why we are calling them as perforators. Now, these perforating veins are also having valves, which ensures that blood flows only from the superficial vein to the deep vein. So similarly, as we said about the saphenofemoral valve, if there is any problem associated with the valves of these communicating veins, blood can get accumulated in the superficial veins as well. About that we will see later on. So this is about perforator veins. Now in the case of great saphenous vein, there are five main perforators. So first is the medial angle perforators of Cochlear. There are three medial angle perforators, and these perforators are lying above the medial manubrium, just above the medial manubrium. In the leg, we saw that the saphenous vein is having one tributary, which is the posterior arch vein. So these communicating veins are arising from the posterior arch vein, and these are connected to the posterior tibial vena comitans. You know, what are vena comitans? These are veins accompanying a major artery. So the posterior tibial artery is accompanied by the vena comitans, and that is what forms the posterior tibial vein. Now these angle perforators are connecting the posterior arch vein directly to this posterior tibial veins. Then we have Boyd's perforator. These are below knee perforators, perforators just below the knee joint, and these are connecting the saphenous vein to the posterior tibial vein similarly. Then we have mid-type perforators or Hunterian perforators. These are connecting the saphenous vein directly to the femoral vein. So there are mainly five named perforators. So there are three medial angle perforators of Cochlear. There is one Boyd's perforator, there is below knee perforators, and then we have Hunterian perforators, which is mid-type perforators. So these are the communicating veins associated with great saphenous vein. So that is about the general anatomy related to the saphenous vein. Now let's see the clinical aspects related to this vein. So first we have vein section. Suppose we are having a patient in emergency, and we are to supply in a patient in an emergency, we have to supply anything, suppose a drug intravenously, and if all the other superficial veins in the body is collapsed for this patient, we can choose the saphenous vein to provide the intravenous infusion, because saphenous vein is a superficial vein, very superficial. We can easily give an intravenous infusion in this vein if it is required. So see, it is in the case of an emergency for long IV administration, and we usually give this in the front of the medial manubrium. So in front of the medial manubrium, the saphenous vein is also accompanied by the saphenous nerve. So the only thing we have to take care of is that we should not damage this nerve when we are giving an IV infusion via the saphenous vein at this region, right? Now there is the saphenous vein graft. Suppose we are doing a coronary artery bypass surgery. For a coronary artery graft, we can choose a saphenous vein as a graft, which is usually taken from a thigh. And since these veins are having valves, we must ensure that these veins are inserted in the reverse manner, because if the valves are present, this will cause block of the blood flow because of the valves. So if you are choosing saphenous vein grafts, we must make sure that the graft is inserted in a reverse manner so that the valves does not obstruct the blood flow. Now we come to the most important clinical aspect related to saphenous vein, that is the varicose vein. Now what do you mean by varicose veins? When the veins get dilated and tortuous because there is accumulation of blood inside the veins, this is what we call as varicose vein. Now what is a major cause of varicose veins? This is usually associated with seen in people who are having jobs such as require long standing, such as in the case of doctors, in the case of bus conductors, or even nurses. This is usually seen in people who have jobs associated with long standing. So when the person does long, prolonged standing, the valves in these veins, in the superficial vein, or even the communicating veins, can get incompetent. So when the valves of these veins get incompetent, the blood can also flow in the reverse manner. Because of this reverse flow of blood, there is accumulation of blood in the superficial vein, and this causes dilatation of the vein, and the veins become tortuous. This is what we call as varicose. Now this valves can become incompetent either in the superficial vein or either in the communicating vein. Suppose if you are considering the veins of the valves of the perforator veins or the communicating veins. See, these veins are communicating the superficial veins with the deep veins. So suppose if the valves of these communicating veins are gone, what is the problem? Because when we know that our calf muscles, the gastrocnemius and the soleus, is also called as the peripheral heart. Why? Because when these muscles are contracting, this force of contraction is pushing the blood upwards, which is helping in the flow of blood from the lower limb up to the heart because of the contraction of these muscles. So because of this force of contraction, the blood can have a tendency to regurgitate back into the superficial veins. So because these communicating veins are having valves, this regurgitation is prevented. So what happens if the valves are damaged or valves are having any issues? The blood can easily regurgitate back into the superficial veins, and then this can cause varicose vein. So incompetent perforator valves, blood from the deep veins can easily regurgitate back into the superficial veins and can cause varicose vein. What about superficial veins? We said that there is a valve in the saphenofemoral junction. This is the most common valve which is getting incompetent, which causes varicose vein. When the valve with the saphenofemoral junction becomes incompetent, blood from the femoral vein can easily enter into the saphenous vein, so which can also cause varicose vein. So the varicosity originates from the junction and flows downwards because the blood is coming into the saphenous vein via the saphenofemoral, from the saphenofemoral junction. So the blood is going from the, flowing downwards from the upper part of thigh. So these two valves, class of valves, can easily get incompetent, and this can cause varicose vein. Now what are the complications associated with varicose vein? Most importantly, it causes inflammation of the veins, which is what you call as thrombophlebitis. This inflammation is associated with pain, local swelling, redness or tenderness. All in signs of inflammation is seen. Then this can also cause venous ulcers. Because of the stagnation of this blood, there is deficient oxygen supply to the skin. And because of this, ulcers are being developed in the leg. So venous ulcers, we have thrombophlebitis. And similarly, the dilated veins can easily undergo hemorrhage. If there is a trauma to these dilated veins, hemorrhage can occur. So these are the few complications associated with the varicose vein. We have thrombophlebitis, we have venous ulcers, we have hemorrhage if there is any trauma to the dilated veins. Now, how do we identify what is the site of all these problems? Now, which valve is affected? What is the cause of this varicose vein? So I said varicose vein can occur either if there is incompetency of the superficial valve. It can occur if there is an incompetency in the communicating valve. It can also occur if there is any block in the deep veins. Suppose if there is a block in the deep veins, blood cannot flow into the deep veins from the superficial veins, right? So this can cause accumulation of blood in the superficial veins, and this can cause varicose vein. So how do we identify which site is causing this issue? We are mainly doing two tests to identify this. One is Trudhelenburg test or Brody-Trudhelenburg test. We are doing this test to identify if the problem lies in the superficial or the perforating veins. So to identify the problems, if the problem lies in the superficial vein or the lies in the perforating vein, we are using this Trudhelenburg test. Now, so how are we doing this test? So we are asking, first of all, we are asking the patient to lie down in a recumbent position. We are asking the patient to lie down, and we are raising the leg up. We are raising the aqueductal leg up. Why? We are supposed to drain the blood completely. We are doing this because we have to drain the blood in the superficial veins. So when we are raising the leg up, the blood from the superficial veins will mainly via the saphenofemoral junction will flow into the deep vein. So we are raising the leg up, we are emptying the superficial veins. Now once the veins are emptied, what we are doing is we are applying pressure to the saphenofemoral junction, usually done with a thumb. Sometimes even the tourniquet can also be applied to the just below the saphenofemoral junction, but usually what we are doing is we are using a thumb. So we are applying pressure at the saphenofemoral junction using the thumb. Now we are asking the patient to stand up quickly. So see, here we see a tourniquet is being shown, but usually we can use a tourniquet, but usually we are applying pressure at the junction using our thumb. Now after the pressure is applied, we are asking the patient to stand up quickly. So this is the procedure. So first of all we are asking the patient to lie down. We are raising his or her leg up so that the blood in the superficial veins can be drained completely. After it is drained, we are applying pressure in the junction, mainly by using the thumb, or a tourniquet can be applied in the below the junction. And we are asking the patient to stand up quickly. Now, how do we differentiate between the issue in superficial veins and communicating veins? So suppose we are testing for the superficial veins. We are asking the patient to stand up quickly, and after the patient stands up, we are removing the pressure. So the pressure from the junction is released. We are taking the thumb away. Now suppose if the pressure is released, now what if there is a problem in the saphenofemoral valve? If the valve in the saphenofemoral junction is incompetent, immediately blood from the deep veins will be flowing back into the superficial vein. So if the valves are incompetent, when the pressure is released, blood will be immediately flowing back into the superficial veins. So which means that when the pressure is released, we can see that the superficial veins are starting to get dilated because the blood is flowing back into the superficial veins. So if the veins are being filled, or if the veins are getting dilated when the pressure is released, that means the issue lies in the saphenofemoral valve, or in the issues in the superficial vein. So when the pressure is released, the saphenofemoral valve is incompetent, blood easily can flow from the femoral vein down to the saphenous vein. So this causes dilatation of the superficial vein, and this we can identify this as an issue with the superficial vein. Now what if we are testing for the perforating veins or communicating veins? We ask the patient to stand up, and we are maintaining the pressure for 1 minute. We are maintaining this pressure for 1 minute. Now what if the pressure is maintained for 1 minute? When we are maintaining the pressure at the saphenofemoral junction, because of the pressure, blood cannot flow through that junction. Now even after the pressure is applied in the saphenofemoral junction, if the superficial vein is getting dilated, that means blood is flowing into the superficial veins via some other route, and that is only via the perforating veins. So even if the pressure is maintained and the superficial veins are getting filled, that means the problem lies in the perforating veins. So this is how you differentiate between an issue with the superficial vein or issue with the perforating vein. So if you are testing for the superficial vein, the pressure from the junction is quickly released. And after releasing the pressure, if the superficial vein is getting filled, that means the problem is in the superficial veins. Now, if you are maintaining the pressure for 1 minute, and if even after the pressure is maintained, if the veins are getting filled, that means the problem is with the perforating vein. So this is how we are using Trendelenburg's test to differentiate between superficial veins and perforating vein incompatibility. Now, how do you identify if the problem lies with the deep veins? For that, we are using something which is called as Perthes test. So we are doing this test to test the incompatibility of deep veins. So here what we are doing, we are tying a tourniquet on the upper part of the thigh. We're tying a tourniquet to the upper part of thigh, and we are asking the patient to walk. We are asking the patient to do some exercise. So usually we ask the patient to walk. So a tourniquet is tied to the upper thigh, and we are asking the patient to walk. See, how do we test this? When the patient is walking, suppose if there is a block in the deep vein. If the deep veins are blocked, the blood from the superficial vein cannot flow into the deep veins. So when the person is walking, if the saphenous vein is shrinking, that means blood is flowing into the deep veins. So if the blood is easily flowing from the saphenous vein to the deep veins, there is no issues. But if there is a block in the deep vein, the saphenous vein will get more distended because blood cannot flow into the deep vein. So that is how we are distinguishing using this test. So if the perforators and the deep veins are normal, the saphenous vein will shrink because blood from the saphenous vein can easily flow into the deep veins. If the saphenous vein is getting more and more distended, that means the deep veins are blocked and the blood cannot flow into the deep veins. So this is how we are identifying if the problem lies in the deep vein. So we are usually doing these two tests to identify if the problem is with the incompetent valves of superficial vein or the communicating veins, or if the problem is associated with the deep veins. So that is about varicose veins. And this is about the anatomy of the great saphenous vein and the different clinical aspects of the great saphenous vein.